Here's a simple C program. It fills an array with random numbers and counts the sum of those that are less than 100. We measure the time it takes to run this for loop, and it takes approximately 34 seconds. But here's the twist. What happens if we sort the array before the loop? Just add a call to qsort, a standard sorting function in C. I sort array in ascending order, then run it again. Now the time is cut almost in half, twice as fast. Why? We didn't change the logic, we just sorted the data.
If you think this is just a C language trick, it's not. I ran the same logic program in different languages. In Java, the unsorted array ran in 7.11 seconds, sorted in 6.99. In C++, unsorted is almost 33 seconds, and sorted, 13.6 seconds. Even in Python, the sorted version is faster. The actual numbers vary between languages, but the pattern is the same. Sorted data always wins.
So clearly this isn't about the programming language. But why does this happen? The answer lies deep inside your CPU, in something called branch prediction.
But before we dive into what branch prediction is, let's take a quick look at how your processor actually works. At its core, the CPU has one job: to execute instructions. These instructions can be simple math operation, like 2 plus 2 or 5 divide 2, or more complex, like comparing two values or jumping to a different part of the program. In C, there's a keyword called goto that allows jumping to another place in the code, though most programmers try to avoid it because it can make code harder to read and maintain. When you write a program in any high-level language, you're not directly writing instructions for the processor. That's because processors can't understand high-level languages like Python, Java, or C++. To fix this problem, we use something called a compiler. For C, it can be GCC. A compiler is a special program that translates your high-level code into low-level instructions, something your processor can actually understand, usually in the form of assembly language. After compilation, your code becomes a long list of tiny, precise commands called instructions. These instructions tell the CPU exactly what to do, step by step. So basically, instruction is a tiny command that the processor understands and follows.
Now that we understand what instructions are, let's take a closer look at how the processor executes them. To help explain this, let's use a real-life analogy. Imagine you work at McDonald's, and for each customer order, you have to complete 4 steps. Here I have a diagram. The horizontal axis represents the steps of the process, and the vertical axis represents different customer orders. To complete one order, you have to do the following.
First, take the order from the customer. Second, prepare the food. Third, pack the order. Fourth, hand it to the customer.
You repeat this process many times throughout the day. If you're working alone, you can only do one step at a time. Finish one full order before starting the next.
In processor terms, this is similar to a scalar processor, one that executes a single instruction or data item at a time.
Instead of calling them steps, like in our McDonald's example, processors use the words clock cycle and clock rate. A clock cycle is one tiny unit of time when the processor does some work. The clock rate is how many of these cycles happen each second. The higher it is, the faster the processor. You can check the clock rate of your own processor too. For example, here's a processor from the Intel Pentium series. As you can see, it has a clock rate of 3.20 gigahertz. The letter G stands for giga, which means billion. So to get the actual number of clock cycles per second, we multiply 3.2 times 10 to the 9 equals 3.2 billion clock cycles per second. That means that processor can do billions of instructions every second. Pretty fast, right?
Back to McDonald's. Now I'll start using the term cycle instead of step, just like in a real processor. Let's say you're no longer working alone. Now there are 4 workers, and each one handles one part of the process. Worker 1 takes the orders. Worker 2 prepares the food. Worker 3 packs the order. Worker 4 hands it to the customer. Here's how it works. On the first cycle, only worker 1 is busy, taking the first order. On the second cycle, worker 1 takes a new order, while worker 2 starts preparing the first one. On the third cycle, worker 3 packs the first order, worker 2 is preparing the second, and worker 1 takes a third order.
By the fourth cycle, all four workers are active, each working on a different step of a different order. From that point on, one order gets completed every single cycle. So, even though each order still takes four steps, the team completes one full order per cycle, which means the restaurant works up to four times faster. This is exactly how instruction pipelining works in modern CPUs. Of course, instead of preparing food, the processor is executing different stages of instructions. In this case, where the processor handles one instruction across four stages, it's called a four-stage pipeline.
Thanks to this parallelism, instructions flow through the CPU like items on an assembly line, with a new instruction being completed every cycle, just like how one order is completed per step in our restaurant.
Now that we understand how pipelining works, let's see it in action with a simple C program and its corresponding assembly code. Imagine our processor has a three-stage pipeline. This means that once fully utilized, the CPU can complete up to three instructions per clock cycle.
I mark the first three instructions with letters A, B, and C. The processor divides one operation into three parts, then execute them in order as shown on the diagram. Even though each instruction still takes three stages to complete, new instructions are being processed in parallel. This also shows an important feature of pipelines. They require some warm-up time before reaching peak performance.
This code is ideal for the processor, a straight-line sequence of instructions with no interruptions. However, things become more complex when we introduce conditional operations, such as if, else, or switch statements. These introduce branches into the program's control flow. An if statement works by evaluating a condition. If the condition is true, it runs one block of code. In our case, that's the code on line 7. If the condition is false, it jumps to an alternative block. Here, that's line 9. This jump is called a branch, and it breaks the smooth, sequential flow of the processor's instruction pipeline. Let's take a look at how this branching is implemented in assembly language.
Let's focus on this part of the assembly. Instruction CMP compares values in if brackets. Then JNE means jump if not equal. Go to point.L2, in C code it's else block, if the result is false. But here's the issue. The processor doesn't know which path will be taken until the condition is evaluated. This causes a stall in the pipeline. The CPU can't fetch the next instructions until it knows which branch to take. To solve this, modern CPUs use a technique called branch prediction. Rather than waiting, the CPU guesses which path will be taken and begins executing instructions from that path immediately. If the guess is correct, the pipeline flows without interruption. If the guess is wrong, the CPU discards the incorrect instructions, called a pipeline flush, and restarts from the correct path, causing a delay. It might sound risky to rely on guessing, but CPUs are extremely good at this. They use past behavior and patterns to make very accurate predictions, over 95% accurate in many cases. So while branching introduces complexity, branch prediction keeps performance high most of the time.
Back to our code from the beginning. How branch prediction works in this exact situation. In the first version, without array sorting, we fill the array with completely random numbers. Then, we're running the loop, and for every element, we write the result of the if statement to another list. If the conditions are met, we write T for true. Otherwise, we write N for not true. So the new list might look something like this. It's completely random, no clear pattern.
And here comes the problem. The processor tries to predict whether the if statement will be true or false on each iteration. With no pattern, the predictor starts guessing, and guessing wrong causes a pipeline flush which slows everything down. When we sort the array first, something changes. Now the result of the if statement will look like this, a clear pattern. The branch predictor loves this. All values up to index 5 are true, then all others are false. And now it almost never guesses wrong, without pipeline flush and unnecessary halt.
This is why the sorted version of the array runs much faster, even though the algorithm is technically doing the same amount of work. So that's all for today. I hope you found the video interesting. If you did, feel free to leave a like, drop a comment, and subscribe for more. I'd really appreciate your support. Thanks for watching. See you next time.